here. A little song to sing for you. Matt Nicole, she does something.
Ah, there we go.
She's really there. And does things.
Nicole Sandler Show, whatever it is.
Yeah, we're here. Good morning and welcome to a Tuesday. I think YouTube got off to a rocky start, but when it clicked on, what you likely saw, well, let me put it back up, is the new cover of the new edition of Charlie Hebdo, the magazine out of Paris, France, that is known as a satirical newspaper. You know, I got to say, many media outlets here in the U.S. will not show this magazine cover. In fact, yesterday, I resisted every impulse I had to grab the remote control and change the channel. When Ronan Farrow was on doing a report from Paris, speaking with the, the now current editor of Charlie Hebdo about this new issue that's coming out. And Ronan Farrow, in all his holier-than-thou-ness, said, well, we will not be showing the cover because this is so offensive. I got to ask, if Islam does not show pictures of Muhammad, their prophet, how do they know that this cartoon portrayal is supposed to be Muhammad? Why isn't it just some guy with a turban and a beard? But even if it's a given, and this is supposed to be a depiction of Muhammad, why is this offensive? I keep hearing, and I'm sure there are a lot of cartoons published by Charlie Hebdo that I have not seen. Granted, I speak very little French. Je m'appelle Nicole. Comment allez-vous? You know, I know those things. I know how to say j'ai mal à la tête, j'ai mal à la stomach from my fourth grade French. Yeah, I have a headache. I have a stomach ache. Important things when you're in fourth grade, right? And my name and things like that. But I do know what this says. The headline above the picture of who is ostensibly a cartoon depiction of Muhammad, holding the sign that says "Je suis Charlie," we are Charlie. Above it, in handwriting, says "Tu es pardon," or I'm probably mispronouncing it, but "All is forgiven" is the headline. To me, that sounds like something in the spirit of the Solidarity March that happened on Sunday in Paris. You know, the march that no one from the U.S. attended. Yeah. Once again, great commentary from the one and only Jon Stewart.
As you remember last week, Islamic extremists carried out a deadly targeted attack on the offices of the satirical French magazine Charlie Hebdo, trying to strike a blow against free expression, the right to offend. Well, this Sunday, France answered.
The largest demonstration ever in French history. Between 1.2 and 1.6 million people rallied in Paris.
Vive la France!
Wow! 1.6 million Parisians in the streets. Are we sure they weren't on strike? Was that a strike? I mean, I don't blame them. I mean, a 12-hour work month, that'll push anyone. Nah, really, it's inspiring to see millions of Parisians taking time out of their mandatory month-long vacation to participate in the, look, we're all united behind France, but if we suddenly start shying away from mocking the French with tired stereotypes, the terrorists win.
And it's true. I mean, you know, it's funny, but it's true.
And it wasn't just ordinary Parisians who took to the streets.
At the head of the rally, a line of political leaders from around the world.
Behind a line of 40 world leaders, their arms linked in a show of solidarity,
they marched.
Oh my God, it's the world's most powerful game of Red Rover ever. They are daring terrorism to come over. And of course, no grand show of liberty is complete without America,
mm-hmm.
the country that invented freedom.
Oh, right.
That's why President Obama was there, front and center.
What?
No top level U.S. presence here. No president, no vice president, no first lady, no former president.
Where was the president?
Where was President Obama?
What is, I don't know. How could Obama not be there? Look how many world leaders he could have bowed down to and apologized. He missed an opportunity.
Right?
How could the U.S. not be there when representatives of such beacons of freedom and lack of censorship as journalist punishing Russia mm-hmm. was there, journalist mm-hmm. jailing Turkey was there,
mm-hmm.
Egypt, Nuff said.
Nuff said.
Palestinian cartoonist jailing Israel was there. And of course, our greatest ally, Saudi Arabia, was there, although a little out of breath, having just days ago flogged a blogger.
Uh-huh.
Couldn't Obama have at least sent a friend?
Attorney General Eric Holder was in Paris.
Okay, all right, there you go. All right, I jumped to conclusions. Eric Holder, the top law official in the United States, our Attorney General. I mean, come on, France. Holder's not good enough for you. You guys are only happy with le grand fromage.
Although Attorney General Eric Holder was in Paris for counterterrorism meetings, he did not attend the march.
What the f***? Eric Holder, you were in France, in Paris, at the time of the march, and we're like, eh. Oh, I get it. You're probably taking advantage of the shortest tourist lines in French history.
Uh-huh.
While the march is going on, you're just kicking back, snapping selfies with the Mona Lisa, stealing catacomb bones, finally getting a table at France's most popular rat-owned bistro. Is that what you were doing? Unbelievable! An enormous global rally in supporting freedom of expression after attack on a close ally, and the U.S. was a no-show? It's going to take a lot to make up for this.
John Kerry said this morning he will go to France later this week.
Je suis to be kidding me. We'll be right back.
Je suis to be kidding me. You gotta love John Stewart. It is absurd, right? The fact that we sent no one. Now, yesterday during the press briefing, White House spokesman Josh Earnest, he admitted they made a mistake. My goodness, but boy, did they go on.
On the topic du jour, why did neither President Obama or Vice President Biden or Eric Holder attend the Paris Solidarity March this summer? Mm-hmm.
Well, Jim, I can tell you that what was on the television screens of people across this country, and I think even across the globe, was a remarkable display of unity by the French people in the face of these terrible terror attacks. And the way that that country has come together, I do think, struck a chord and inspired people all across the world. And
all right. And that went on for another 4 minutes. Josh Earnest sort of talking around it. I don't think he ever said we made a mistake, like in those simple words. That's all he had to say. We fucked up. All right. But he went on for 4.5 minutes, basically saying we made a mistake without, I don't ever think, uttering those words. And then, of course, Ed Henry, now of the fake news channel, just berated him, you know. So that's how it went yesterday. Should be noted, though, while NBC won't show the new cover of the new issue of Charlie Hebdo that is now up on the screen yet again. And I think most, I think CNN said they won't show it. A number of other news, Laffy in the chat room said that last night, both Lawrence O'Donnell and Rachel Maddow were complaining about being censored, that NBC would not allow them to show this image. Really? Really? That guess who showed it on their TV screen this morning? fox. That's right. A fox. The epitome of everything that's wrong with so-called news. Just, you know, I haven't played this in a while, but I think it's time for me to whip this one out.
Welcome to Opposite World, where in is out and up is down. Brought to you by Honorable Speaker of the House, Little Johnny Boner, and his really big gavel.
Yeah, nothing sort of makes sense. I guess Fox probably is doing this, hoping that someone might attack them and they could say, see, I told you. You know, it was interesting yesterday. There was sort of a Twitter battle going on. Sometimes it's fun just to sit back and watch on Twitter. And what we were watching yesterday was J.K. Rollins. She the woman behind Harry Potter, right? Going after Rupert Murdoch for good reason. Rupert Murdoch had tweeted that, quote, most Muslims, even if peaceful, must be held responsible for the religion's, quote, growing jihadist cancer in the wake of the terror attacks in France. Really? Most Muslims, even if peaceful? There was another bit on The Daily Show, which I don't have. I actually just saw it when I was getting my final cup of coffee for the morning. David had it on in the living room. And they had a panel on The Daily News. There was a, I don't even know the guy's name, but I guess the resident Muslim, and who stated, as a Muslim, I absolutely, unequivocally, wholeheartedly, without a doubt, and every other assertive statement to that point, wholeheartedly condemn this acts of terrorism. You know, basically what those pundits are saying, we need to hear all the moderate Muslims speak out against it. And they have been. And he did, full-throated, unequivocal, absolute, without doubt, condemns it. And then Jason Jones says, yeah, I'm not quite sure I believe him. Hello, that's Rupert Murdoch for you. So J.K. Rowling tweeted back to him, I was born Christian. If that makes Rupert Murdoch my responsibility, I'll auto-excommunicate. Boy, that, you know, the mark of a great author. She says so much in so few words, doesn't she? But then again, out of all the cable news and over-the-air networks, Fox might be the only one who showed this cover of Charlie Hebdo today. The new issue of the magazine, which usually has a circulation of about 50 to 60,000, and I think they usually only publish in French, I think today will release this edition, 3 million copies in multiple languages. I'd say the terrorists lost on this round. Not that anyone's keeping score, right? So that happened yesterday. There's so much more going on. In fact, if you listen to the pre-show music today and wondered why the sort of people power theme of the music, you know, every day I play pre-show music for anywhere from 15 to 30 minutes before the show actually begins, for those who tune into the stream early, either at radioornot.com or, you know, on our TuneIn channel. And usually, not always, but usually the songs have a theme. And today it was People Power. It was Get Up, Stand Up by Bob Marley. It was Leonard Cohen's Democracy, Tom Petty, I Won't Back Down, Patti Smith, People Have the Power. You get the idea, right? Well, the reason is because, well, I guess it happened over the weekend, but it was made news yesterday that the progressives won. Here's the latest battle. I'm going to read to you from Huffington Post. Wall Street banker Antonio Weiss has asked President Barack Obama not to renominate him to a top Treasury Department post because of the fight being waged against him by Senator Elizabeth Warren, Bernie Sanders, and other progressives. Well, the article says, and other Democrats. But really, it's progressives. First reported by Politico, Weiss wrote to Obama over the weekend saying that he didn't think the Treasury Department, quote, would be well served. by the lengthy confirmation process his nomination would likely entail, given the level of Democratic opposition he has faced. Right? Let's see. White House spokeswoman Jennifer Friedman confirmed in a statement to the Huffington Post that Weiss asked not to be renominated because he didn't want to be a distraction for the administration. And then there was the printed statement. But basically, you know what? This shows that when progressives band together and stand up for something, that we can win. Here, back to this Huffington Post article. So in recent weeks, more than half a dozen Democratic senators announced they didn't support Weiss for the post because of his overly close ties to Wall Street. The progressive activist group Credo, meanwhile, collected more than 160,000 signatures on a petition urging them to oppose Weiss. Senator Al Franken said Weiss made the right decision to take himself out of the running, and on it goes. And again, the loudest voices opposing Weiss were Senators Elizabeth Warren and Bernie Sanders. Yep. You see, when we stand strong to our ideals, we win. Now, there is sort of a downside to the story, which is that this guy Weiss, this Wall Street guy, will not be number three at Treasury, but the president will appoint him as a special advisor to Treasury Secretary Jack Lew, which doesn't need any congressional confirmation. So they both sort of win. But, you know, good for Elizabeth Warren. Now, Elizabeth Warren's still not showing any signs that she might reconsider and run for the presidency. And there are many on the left who are saying that's good because she actually, in the Senate, she has the power to stop things like Antonio Weiss from being confirmed as the number three at Treasury. As president, oddly enough, she wouldn't have such power, but she wouldn't nominate him in the first place. She'd put forth the right people for the positions, which I, you know, think is important. But, you know, I understand the arguments that Elizabeth Warren can, in many ways, be more effective as a leading progressive voice in the U.S. Senate. So there's that. The other thing to sort of take a little bit of glee in this morning, perhaps, is, well, looks like Mitt Romney's running. Yeah, after saying over and over and over again that no, he's done, after Ann Romney, it's our turn, it's Mitt's turn, said never again, she may be forced to eat those words. Mitt 3.0 is gearing up for a run. Oh my God, let the comedy ensue. All right. So all that is going on today and a lot more. On the show today, it is Tuesday, and in the second hour, it is the first gathering of the Gliberal Goddesses for 2015. GottaLaff, Amy Simon, and I will talk about whatever we feel like talking about. It's not limited to politics. It's not limited to women's issues. It's not limited to anything, whatever comes up, we will discuss. And it could be, since both Laffy and Amy live in California, you know, late last week, Barbara Boxer announced she will not be running for re-election. She will not be seeking another term in the U.S. Senate in 2016, when she is up. So now the hat-throwing competition begins in California. And yesterday, I was grateful to hear that Lieutenant Governor Gavin Newsom will not be running, because he's really not a good guy. I don't like him. But California Secretary of State Kamala Harris will announce today that she will be running. Now, I thought that was a good thing, but some progressives I know entrenched in the progressive infrastructure in California say, she's not as good as they tell us that she is. But we'll see. So, you know, we'll keep an eye on that. We can talk a little bit about that. But there's another story that was made headlines yesterday. Now, if you're watching on YouTube, here's a tweet that crossed my Twitter stream yesterday from @CENTCOM. CENTCOM, as you may know, U.S. Central Command controls the military action, actually based down here in Florida, right? And the tweet from the CENTCOM Twitter account reads, "In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful, the cyber caliphate continues its cyber jihad." Yeah, and here's another one. This is the profile page of the Twitter account formerly belonging to U.S. Central Command at CENTCOM. And the Twitter profile had been taken over by a group that calls itself Cyber Caliphate. And the picture sort of obscures the slogan there that I think said, "We love you, ISIS," or something equally absurd. Not only was CENTCOM's Twitter account hacked yesterday, taken over by a group alleging to be affiliated with ISIS, their YouTube page was as well. So this is only the latest in a string of hacking incidents that have made news, right? CENTCOM got their stuff back within a couple of hours, and they took their Twitter account and Facebook, and YouTube account down, and apologized and all that. So now they're back to normal. But this follows, of course, in recent weeks, the very highly publicized hacking of Sony Pictures Studios, interface, their whole network apparatus. And we know what harm was done there, although there are still questions as to who was behind the hacking. There is no question about the fact that, yes, they were hacked. We're hearing so much about, you know, the bad hacking. But on this program, in the wake of Ferguson, right, while all the protests were going on, while things got really ugly there, and we started hearing from KKK members, I mean, who would have ever, I never would have even imagined that the Ku Klux Klan, you know, and their various chapters have Twitter accounts. But so they did. And Anonymous came forward and said, no, absolutely not. And Anonymous began not only hacking into all the KKK online websites and Twitter accounts and Facebook pages, and taking them down, but really going after the bad guys. You know, here I am applauding. Go Anonymous. Yeah, baby. And even more recently, Anonymous has announced that they are going after jihadist websites too. Taking them down, exposing the perpetrators behind the hate speak. And I don't know about you, but I welcome this kind of activity, which brings to light an industry. I had never even heard the term ethical hacker before a week or two ago when I was out on a boat with some friends, and there was another person on the boat, a woman who I met who lives down here in Miami, and she started telling me about Ralph Echemendia, who is known as the ethical hacker. His website is theethicalhacker.net. And of course, this was before the CENTCOM hack happened. And I thought, wow, I really want to talk to this guy. So, wait no longer. Ralph Echemendia, are you there?
Yes, Nicole, how you doing?
I'm doing well. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. Now, where are you calling in from?
I'm calling in from Munich, Germany right now.
Wow. What are you doing in Germany?
I am working with a director that you might know named Oliver Stone on a movie coming up called the title is still to be determined, but it's The Snowden Files.
So uh-huh.
It's about Snowden.
Well, and you know, it might be with Edward Snowden that I think the idea of somebody hacking for good came into at least mass consciousness. Obviously, you've been in this field for a long time. You know, it's funny because I know better than to watch TV crime shows and think that they have any basis in fact. But lately, I've been obsessed with this one show called Criminal Minds. And really, at the core of this FBI group is a woman who had been arrested by the FBI for her hacking skill, you know, because she was a big hacker. And now she can pull out any information about anyone in a moment's notice. She's like, she's the reason they break all these cases. Now, again, I think it's probably oversimplifying things, although who knows, maybe somebody with those skills can get whatever information they want about anybody like that, if you know where to look and how to go. And the fact is, now she had been turned from, you know, a life of crime to a life of, you know, crime fighting, because, you know, that's TV. They wrap it all up in 48 minutes or whatever. But is that realistic?
To some degree, yes. And you're going to see a lot more on TV related to this hacking and how it's used for good and bad, obviously. But there is some reality to that.
Now, so Ralph Echemendia, your website, theethicalhacker.net, and looking on the website, this website really is, you teach people how to protect themselves against hackers. Is that the main thrust of what you do?
Yes, and the way to do that is to actually teach them how to hack.
Wow.
So we teach them the process and the mindset and the tools. Now, obviously, we don't teach intent, but the intent is that by teaching this, you can kind of do it to your own systems, and you now have an understanding when you're deploying technology that it could be done and deployed in such a way where you're making it as secure as possible. There is, Nicole, the truth is there is no 100% protection, and it isn't going to exist. But the idea is to build resilience in the systems that we use. And by resilience, I mean the ability to continue to work. A good example of that is Sony. So that's zero resilience. When an entire corporation of that size is taken down by probably, you know, a handful of people, that's not being very resilient. So it's a matter of deploying systems in such a way where they are as secure as they can be, and at the same time having a plan in place to how to operate once you've been hacked, and how to detect that you've been hacked quickly enough so that it does not impact you to the degree that it impacted a company like Sony, or for that matter, you personally, right?
Uh-huh. Now, so if the Sony, when the story broke and oh my God, personal information about employees were being leaked, and I mean, we heard the extent of the damage done to Sony. I also saw reports that said, you know, their defense mechanism, their security was really lax. Obviously, they didn't bring in anyone like you to show them how to protect their infrastructure. So we know that much. Do you agree that they really were lax in protecting the information they had available on, you know, on the internet?
The problem is that it's not to say that Sony was any less lax than most companies. The truth is that security is often seen as you know, the bastard stepchild of IT, of the IT department, right? So it is, in fact, the more alarming thing about Hollywood is that, and I work a lot with Hollywood, is that in organizations, for example, in the financial sector, you have what's called a, you know, just like you have a CFO, chief financial officer, you tend to have a CISO, a chief information security officer, somebody who interfaces between, at a high level, between the executives and the operations. And in Hollywood, that doesn't exist. So it is just a function and responsibility of the IT department. And security is something that goes outside of just technology. That is the truth. That's unfortunately the case, is that you know, there's a lot more to security than just the technology aspect of it. So Sony was lax, just like most other organizations are also lax, in the detection of security breaches. We know to some degree that these attackers in Sony were in there for months, and that could be 6 months to a year before they were, you know, detected. And they weren't detected. They were only detected because employees came in one morning and they had a screen that said, "You've been hacked."
Wow. Now, so Ralph Echemendia is with us, again, theethicalhacker.net. I want to go back to, so Sony, we've got the government, the FBI just came out again last week and said, we know for sure the hack came from North Korea, and yet, cybersecurity experts have been saying, I don't think so. And the general consensus among people, And I don't know where you stand on this. I'll ask in a second. But from experts that I've heard is like, no, they think it was an inside job using what are known as proxy servers that may run through North Korea. But that their indications are that it was somebody from maybe a disgruntled former employee who had access to, passwords or whatever. What do you think happened with Sony?
Well, I have looked at all of those documents. I work with the LA Times and was quoted in the LA Times a number of times because I got to look at all the Sony documents, and as well as having some other information in addition to that. There was a very, when I say high up, I mean they had high level of access, who worked in the IT department, a female that was let go in a very bad way.
Ooh.
Interestingly enough, within the last year.
Uh-huh.
And as well as a couple of other individuals. But the specific focus is on that lady because she had been there for long enough where she'd know every detail in and out of their systems. So when you put that together with the fact that the initial communications from the hackers to Sony made no mention of the interview or North Korea, that was something that was picked up by the media and reported, months earlier when the announcement of the interview was made. There was, the North Korea had a statement that they were unhappy about it. Now, that's where the relation to North Korea came up, was by the press and the media making that, hey, maybe it was them because they were unhappy about it 6 months ago, okay? And as soon as that happened, then the next communications from the attackers made it seem like it was, to me, that's just propaganda.
Just to throw off, the trail?
Totally, totally. There's a term that we use in the hacking world called trolling.
Mm-hmm.
Trolling is, basically just being a prick online because you can be.
Yes. Know many of those.
So I believe that it is in that direction. As you know, the FBI has said that, they know it's North Korea, and The two things they've mentioned publicly is that they had some IP addresses that the attackers were mixed up once and or twice and ended up using an IP address that sourced back to North Korea. Now that, there's been legal cases on the copyright side of things where judges have already said that that is not enough proof to put the North Korean government or a specific individual behind that IP address.
Mm-hmm.
So that is not by itself in any way proof. The second thing they mentioned was behavioral analysis, that they had done behavioral analysis of the language that was used in these messages, and that that was their second element, because I've always said that you need to have several different data points to be able to say that this is proof, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then on the flip side of that, we have also done a lot of analysis on those communications. And, it's kind of like if you took Google Translate and you put something from English to, to
Korean,
for example, right?
Right.
Well, we took the English and put it from English to Korean, and then we took the English and put it from English to Russian.
Uh-huh.
And it was more like Russian than it was Korean.
Huh.
So, and there is some speculation, as well as some other experts reporting that this individual may have had communications with pro-piracy Russian hackers. So that makes a lot more sense than North Korea hacking a corporation like Sony because of a movie. That's just...
Right. It doesn't make any sense. Right. And North Korea has vehemently denied any involvement. And yet, the FBI statement, sort of doubling down on their contention that it was North Korea, came after a lot of, experts like you said, wait a minute, not so fast. This does not look like it came from North Korea. Is that just like face saving, you think, on the part of the government?
It is, and I really strongly believe that was, a strategic move on both Sony and the government's side, because once you make it an issue against a foreign state like this, then all of a sudden the question you just asked earlier about the whether or not Sony was lax in their IT security goes away, and it becomes more of a political issue. Sony could face... These documents that were leaked, that's the other part about it, were very much handpicked. They got everything and handpicked what they released. So that's the other reason what makes me think that somebody on the inside knew what to look for and where to look for it. But more importantly, the fact that we have stuck to it's North Korea without any real proof. Again, the FBI says that they've wrapped their case, they have obviously made a statement that it's North Korea. So the proof that's been provided to the general population here is not enough, right?
Right.
So I think it was, purely a strategic move on their end to shift the focus from Sony and potential lawsuits that would be flying right now at Sony to that this is a political issue.
Right. All right. So, Ralph Echemendia, am I pronouncing your name correctly?
Well, it's okay, because people say it like that all the time.
How
it's
do you say it?
Echemendia.
Is with us. TheEthicalHacker.net is where you find his headquarters. I went looking for a Twitter handle. Are you not on Twitter?
I am. I go by a kind of hackerish handle. It's Ralph Remix, and the three and the... In the remix word, the E is a three and the I is a one.
Ah, so. Okay. I'll have to find you there, and we'll fix it here on YouTube. But anyway, so yesterday, big news yesterday for that in the hacking world, as the U.S. Central Command official Twitter account at CENTCOM was hacked, and I've got a picture up on YouTube right now. Their profile page was... They changed the picture to Cyber Caliphate. Obviously, they weren't very sophisticated because they had their little icon covering up where something that says, I love you, ISIS, or we love you, something, whatever. But anyway, for at least a couple of hours, they had control of CENTCOM's Twitter account. They tweeted out things like this one that I pulled. There was another one that said, American military, we're coming for you. And then finally, the Twitter account was taken down. The YouTube account, which was also hacked, was taken down. And now today, I guess their Twitter account is back up with apologies. This might be a bit more serious than the Sony hack, do you think?
Well, no. The Sony hack was huge from the perspective of impact.
Right, and the information massive. They put out, right.
And just what they hacked. I mean, they really took this company to their knees. A Twitter handle is just, from my point of view, is just, it allows, it's mostly for social use. And technically speaking, that doesn't mean that anything else was hacked outside of just the username and password that was used for accessing Twitter. However, it is a ballsy move. Right, so it's a message that's being sent there. More importantly than the actual technicality of the hack, it's a message that hey, we're doing this too, right?
So, and again, oftentimes the Twitter account is run by lower level people, right? It's just someone maybe in the PR office, in the press office, to get messages out. So they don't have the top secret clearance or anything like that. It's just, it's a Twitter account or a YouTube account to post videos.
Right. In fact, oftentimes it's neither a contractor or, you know, somebody, like you said, specifically within their social media department or group.
Uh-huh. All right. So cool. So that it, on the surface, because it is U.S. Central Command, looks like it was a bigger deal. But in actuality, not so much. More just theatrics and maybe shock value. Is there any way to find out who was behind that, if it was actually somebody high up in ISIS or a terrorist group, or do we know?
Well, yes, you have, you know, it goes back to that whole thing of tracing the IP address. And again, these folks know to use anonymizing networks and use proxies around the world and so on that make it a lot more difficult to concretely say exactly where it came from. I'm obviously hoping that they did leave enough of a breadcrumb there for investigators to find where it came from.
Yes, and obviously there are people, I'm guessing the government must employ a number of people like you, who this is what you do, you are hackers, like my the Garcia character in Criminal Minds, someone who maybe came out of the hacking community and they saw this person. It's like, oh my God, this person knows what they're doing, and then they hire them?
They do hire hackers, if you will. For a long, long time, that was a big no-no. But as you've seen, you know, everybody from the FBI, there is such a shortage of people who have the time and experience in this field that it's just no way to keep up right now. So, I mean, that's really the issue. It's just massive, you know. In fact, if you were to look at job posting boards like Monster or whatnot, you'll notice that, you know, more than half of management positions in the security space go unfilled every year because there isn't enough people to fill them, you know.
Wow. So this is a booming career field, right? So let me ask you. So Ralph Echemendia is with us, and one of the things you offer is a course on cybersecurity, how to keep, whether it's your personal information private or your corporate information private. You teach people how to do that. And you said in teaching them how to do that, the way to do it is by teaching them how to hack. What about someone like me? I have, I do everything here. I produce my own show. I host it. I do all this technical stuff. But on the website side, I do all that too. Although, as anyone who regularly frequents radioornot.com can tell you, I often have glitches because even WordPress sometimes dumps me. And now I have a caching problem. If there's someone like me whose knowledge is minimal, but I sort of get by, am I teachable?
Oh, absolutely. In fact, Nicole, I think that that's the biggest problem is that, you know, oftentimes, you know, it's security people talking to other security people. You know, the majority of people who come into my classes are all, you know, IT people who are neither needing more security or are going to now be tasked with the security of their system. So the bigger problem is that we're not doing enough in general social awareness of these security problems. And you know, ultimately, it's my mom. I always use the my mom factor.
Uh-huh, right.
What can I do to make my mom more secure and reduce the number of technical support calls I get from her? So I am working on that. It's not something I want to talk too much about. But the problem is it's sort of like, you know, it's the issue of your car and the mechanic.
Right.
There's only so much you can know that's helpful at the very top. And even there just isn't enough information out there available to the masses that use technology. You know, I mean, think about it. Most of us have multiple devices, not one, but several.
Oh, yes.
So there's just so many, and there's literally thousands of ways to hack you. It's not one. There's so many different attack vectors that exist and so on and so forth. So the issue is that you kind of need somebody looking out for you, and that's kind of what I'm working on. It's more of a service-oriented way to address the security issue, and at the same time, educate the user in a way that you are taking into consideration that they're not technical.
Right. And that's important because, again, there are a lot of us who aren't or think we are. But, you know, then I run into a thing where I post something on my blog and I hit refresh and it doesn't show up. It's like, all right, what am I doing wrong? We want everything to happen for us. So the skills are teachable to anyone who even, you know, oftentimes when you start talking computer ease, you know, their eyes roll back in their head.
Exactly. And there's an area that we, and that's the whole thing. Start using a language that's like, you know, doctors and lawyers.
Yeah.
But that's the whole thing is we have to digest that in such a way where we are really thinking about the consumer, if you will. Because ultimately it's really all about every single one of us is a consumer, whether mm-hmm. we're technically savvy or not.
So
and it affects all
right,
of us.
Right. So let me ask you this. So for the people who use, you know, the same password for everything. You got email, you got Facebook, you got, you know, your login to whatever, you know, website you go to all the time, your bank account. How dangerous is that?
It is dangerous. I mean, what I recommend is that you think of it this way. You need three levels of passwords. And so you make it easy for you to remember and how to generate a password this way. You know, you need a password that you use for, say, you know, social media, mm-hmm. Things like that. You need a password that is for your computer and for, you know, files or something like that that you encrypt. So that you know, that would be, for example, your email is something different than social media. So think of social media as one password. Think of things that are next level up, more like your email addresses, more like I said, your you know, that sort of stuff. And then you've got your things like bank accounts.
Right.
And that should be a different email. So that way, I mean,
a different password.
So that way you have, you know, in three different layers, you have the different kinds of information you would have access to. Because if we get one, most people tend to use the same one across all systems.
Right.
And the biggest issue here is email. Because, you know, you go to a website, you forgot your password. Where does it send it to? Your email. So you got access to somebody's email, you got access to all of their accounts, really. So the idea is to kind of layer this approach towards your passwords. The second recommendation I would make about passwords is don't think of them as words anymore. Think of them as a phrase. You know, think of, I always use this one, Mary had a little lamb.
Uh-huh.
Okay, it's not one word, it's a few words. It's something that you know from when you were a child. Maybe it's something your mom told you. Maybe it was your favorite meal. Put it into a sentence.
Lamb. Right. No, I hear it. Right.
And put it into a sentence and then just change, make sure, you know, the first character is uppercase or the last character is uppercase and change one of the letters into a number like E is a 3 or,
right.
you know,
or I is a one. Right.
Right. And just by using that simple approach towards pass phrases, you're creating a much more difficult password, if you will, to crack.
Oh, and, that's great advice.
And it's easy to remember.
Yeah,
you know?
Right.
Pick something that, you know, that you would remember.
Right.
You know?
I love that. Okay. Great advice there. Ralph Echemendia is with us at theethicalhacker.net. All right. Now I need to ask you about this. You heard the intro, but in the wake, when all eyes were on Ferguson, as they probably still should be, we saw Anonymous step in and take on the Klan. Who would have ever imagined that in 2015 we'd still be dealing with the Klan? But they were out there saying and doing horrific things. And Anonymous to the rescue again. I've been a huge fan of Anonymous for a while now, as same as I am a fan of Edward Snowden. Now, Edward Snowden, and you can correct me, please, and again, you're in Germany consulting with Oliver Stone on the film he's making about Edward Snowden. Edward Snowden was in there. He was working with their computer. So I don't know that what he did was actually hacking. He had access to those files. He took them because he saw, he had an attack of a conscience, you know, saying, oh, my God, look what our government's doing in our name. I can't sit back and just do nothing. Much the same as Chelsea Manning, I believe, acted out of not selfishness, but selflessness, you know, working for the greater good. But I think what Anonymous does and has been doing is a whole different level. Do you agree?
I do agree. It's a much broader issue because, you know, Anonymous is a loose organization. It does no leadership, and there's lots of different little, you know, groupings of people that can go under Anonymous. Anyone can be Anonymous, right? Anyone. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of the idea. And the thing is, generally speaking, all of the things they've gone after are all the kinds of things that I think most people in the world would agree to, that they're in the right. So again, it's one of those issues that hacking is illegal. And these guys are saying, well, we don't care. We are going to fight back. As they say, we are legion and we are everywhere. So I generally speaking, I believe in what they've done and what they do. There's a lot of people who might call themselves Anonymous and do the wrong things, but I think as a whole, we know Anonymous to be sort of the Robin Hoods of the internet, you know?
Right, right. That's a great analogy.
And they are and continue to do that, to attack and provide means of communications. If you try to censor the internet, you will be attacked by Anonymous. So it is an important message that they're sending.
And how about their latest, which is they've, you know, said they're going to go after these jihadists and take down their websites. And I know they've been successful on a few fronts. So you're saying that this could be a wholly different group of people than the ones that, for instance, went after the Klan in Ferguson. These are the another group also under the heading Anonymous, but could be a wholly different group of people going after the jihadists who are threatening, you know, terror on the world.
Absolutely. It could be a totally different group of people, but it's still Anonymous, if you will. So it's still for the right cause. And, you know, that's the idea. And they will bring websites down. They've been known to be very successful in doing that. And then more importantly is when they start, you know, putting information out there about detailed information about the people behind that, then they're really making quite an impact because they're lifting the veil on who are these people are.
And see, and I say more power to them. I want to donate to their cause. I mean, I think it's so great that they're doing this, both going after the Klan and please go after, these ISIS and Al-Qaeda affiliated groups who have a big online presence. I mean, they publish magazines, for God's sake. I mean, they are trying to get in the mainstream to recruit disaffected youth, I guess. So I love that they're doing this. But the term hacker in and of itself connotates a negative, right? It's an illegal activity. Hacking is, so that's what gave birth to the term ethical hacker?
That's correct. And it's mostly more, I know it's an oxymoron of a term, but it is a term that kind of came about because of the fact that, first of all, hackers in the earlier days, and amongst us computer nerds, if you will, the term hacking is not a negative thing, or the term hacker is not a negative thing. But to the population and to the media, it has always been portrayed as a negative thing because the news attached to it always have to deal with something that would be illegal. So the thing is, you know, there were many earlier attempts at changing the perception of the word hacker, you know, trying to use the word cracker and trying to use the word attacker and so on and so forth. But hacker stuck. And as a result of that, a couple of different organizations started using the word ethical hacker. In fact, there's a certification that I was involved with for many years earlier on called the Certified Ethical Hacker Certification. Mm-hmm. And I used to teach that class. And, you know, so it just kind of stuck, the ethical hacker term. You know, we have different ways that we also explain this is, you know, you have white hats, and this comes from the old Westerns, and you have black hats, and the black hats are sort of the, you know, the criminals, and the white hats are sort of using the same guns, the same skills as the black hats would. It's, you know, that's the idea. But the truth is that, you know, we're all human beings, and we're all really gray. There's no black or white. Mm-hmm. There's very few people who are truly going to be a black hat or a white hat. I mean, if you hold someone's, you know, mother or child for ransom, a hacker will do whatever they have to do, you know?
Right.
So that's, you know, but most of us in the professional side of things from security, you know, you'll hear the term, oh, they're white hat hackers or they're ethical hackers. Those are the two terms that have kind of stuck with us, even though, as I said, it's quite an oxymoron to use the word ethical and hacker, because the ethics of a hacker, if you look up something like a hacker manifesto or the hacker ethic, you'll note this is not the kind of ethics that any corporation would ever hire.
I see. A question from the chat room, our friend Sox1 in the chat room. First she asked, well, what does it mean bringing a website down and what happens? And then she asked, could the NSA be brought down?
Well, to the first question, bringing a website down is not the most difficult thing in the world from a technology perspective, because, you know, think about it this way. You just have to hammer it with a lot of traffic coming from a lot of different directions. And basically, a computer can only take so much before it just falls on its face, to put it in a non-technical way. So Anonymous is you know, very good at DDoS or distributed denial of service attacks against websites. So that's what I mean by bringing it down, is you just flood it with so much traffic and sometimes malicious traffic that it just will stop working. So it's kind of like, you know, it's like taking your engine too fast. It's going to blow up. On the flip side of that, you were asking about the NSA. Now, the NSA and most intelligence organizations operate in what we'll call here sort of a dark net or a dark web, meaning that they are not very connected to the internet as we know it. They operate on a different internet. I kind of explain it sort of like if you were looking at the stars one night and you see all the stars, that's the internet. Those are websites.
Right.
But then there's all that dark matter in between the stars. That's the dark web, or that's what we call the deep web. You don't see that.
Uh-huh.
But there is a whole other, you know, dark matter, if you will. So organizations like the NSA and such and the CIA operate on that realm, which means they are not as easily to bring down or attack. That does not mean that they are by any means 100% secure. They just are certainly much more resilient to attack than the rest of the world.
This is obviously, this is such a fascinating topic, and I've got millions more questions. I could go on for a while, but we've got the news coming up in just a moment, so we're going to have to wrap for today. But Ralph Echemendia, fascinating stuff. Theethicalhacker.net is where people can find you. On Twitter at Ralph, it's Ralph Remix, but with a 3 instead of an E and a 1 instead of an I. I'll put all the links on my blog at RadioRenat.com after the show. I expect this is going to be a topic we're going to have to talk a whole lot more about, because it's not going away. I hope you'll come back, because I do want to talk more about Edward Snowden, which again is a different issue, but it goes to, you know, national security and privacy and I think, you know, 21st century issues that we're going to have to deal with more and more.
Absolutely, Nicole, and I'll be happy to come back. I mean, I'll leave you with this.
Okay.
The issue, as we go into the next talk about the Snowden issue, is that we have the word security and we have the word privacy. And typically those two words are synonymous to each other. However, in a cyber world that we're living in, we're losing privacy in the name of security. So we have to be careful and give up our privacy in the name of security.
Yeah. Well, and that's what they're telling us. Look, you know, you can have one. Do you think we can have it both? Have it both ways?
I think there's a balance. And that's the problem is right now it's the whole cybersecurity world is very unbalanced. So I think that we need to find a balance, and there has to be some, you know, checks and balances, if you will, especially for those capturing our data and capturing all of our private information.
Yeah, no kidding. Ralph Echemendia, thank you so much. Say hi to Oliver for us and enjoy Germany. And we'll talk again soon, I hope. I really appreciate your time this morning.
Thank you, Nicole. Anytime. My pleasure.
All right.
Thank
take care. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
All right. That fascinating, right? Oh my goodness. I just again, I could have talked with him for hours, and so we'll definitely have him back on. But now
the following program.
Oh no, wrong one again.
Material.
Well, it does, but this is the button I meant to push. Oh boy, it is time for the news. And for that, we turn to our friends at Talk Radio News Service, talkradionews.com. And I believe we've got Bob Ney on the line today. Good morning.
You take the other call, I hear, "Hi." Then with mine, I hear, "Oh boy."
No, well, I hit the wrong button.
It's the news.
It's the news. It is the news. And it's always, what is today going to bring us? Well, that was a discussion, Bob, that usually you get to hear the tail end of it. I was just wrapping it up when you called in. This guy is known as an ethical hacker. He's actually right now in Germany consulting with Oliver Stone on his film about Edward Snowden. But obviously, we were talking about the hacking of the CENTCOM Twitter and YouTube pages and the Sony hacking and of course the bigger picture of Anonymous, who I think is, you know, the most visible of the ethical hackers. I mean, it's hacking for good, and I say more power to him. We need people like that. I think they're the superheroes of the 21st century.
It's like Edward Snowden. If Edward Snowden had not done what he did, and we can say he should have done it here and taken lumps, etc., Edward Snowden hadn't done, we wouldn't be having conversations about how much they're listening to us right now. So,
right,
you know,
that's right.
Certain things that are done, and we say, "Oh, we don't want them to hack. That's so unethical." Are you familiar with Steubenville, Ohio, which is near my hometown?
Oh God, yeah, the high school football rape case. Yeah,
right. I'm in Blair, Ohio, about 17 miles south is my home. Originally, it was the old congressional district. I represented Steubenville in Congress, and if it was not for Anonymous, and yeah, the tactics can be questioned, but if it wasn't for Anonymous, all of the things that were hidden by people in the management of the rape and all the things they tried to destroy would have languished.
That's right. Period. It was Anonymous who actually sort of got the case reopened after, you know, town officials tried to hush it, right?
They did it. And they even, you know, they had enough information that the Attorney General said, "Wow, okay."
That's right.
And he, Mike DeWine, and he went in to find out about it because, you know, the information he had was not, he didn't have access to it. And then they hacked, Anonymous did, and that's it. So I thought I'd mention that, you know, little home area hacking that paid off.
Absolutely. I had forgotten about that. Look, Anonymous has been doing good work for a long time. Well, the ones I pointed out were, you know, more recent, their takedown of the KKK in the aftermath of the mess in Ferguson, right? And now, currently, they have a campaign where they're taking down jihadist websites and online accounts, which, please, thank you. You know, how can I help you, right?
Right.
So it's fighting back. It's people power. Speaking of fighting back and people power, how's this for a segue into the news? How about Elizabeth Warren, Bernie Sanders, and the power of progressives saying no to the Democratic president over his pick for a new number three guy at Treasury, who is a Wall Street guy? They said no, and over the weekend, Antonio Weiss sent the president a letter and said, "Please remove my name from contention. I don't want the job."
Yes, and he's going to, I think he's going to go work for Mr. Liu or something.
Yeah, now he is. He will be an advisor to Jack Liu, which is,
Everybody does that. Why do they, everybody's rejected goes to work for Jack Liu.
Yeah, well, I mean, look, the job he wanted was a treasurer. The job that he was up for was a treasurer. This, I think, is the White House's end run around having to get him confirmed, because the word is now they're not going to fill that number three position yet. Antonio Weiss will just be an advisor in Treasury, a position that doesn't require Senate confirmation.
Right. And, you know, this has been an ongoing issue. As we know, the whole Larry Summers fiasco.
Yes.
And, you know, when it came to the Fed Reserve, the big finance, you know, portion of the government. And that was a fiasco in itself because he was a Wall Street darling. You know, he was a darling of Rubin on the Democratic side and of the Republicans on Wall Street. So, and I know there's a lot of pressure on presidents to do certain things, but I think this should be a signal, combined with the fact that the Democratic minority in the Congress, in the House, came out with a proposal yesterday. It won't be as broad as Senator Sanders would be, in the Senate, but it came out with a proposal to start to do something about income equality. So if you look at that, and they're proposing to go to the top of the food chain, in particular, you know, the Wall Street big bonus deals. And so that kind of it fits in with what was done in the Senate to say, wait a minute, you know, somebody with banking experience is one thing, somebody that is the bank is another.
Yeah,
I think that's the message across the bow.
Now, did the Democrats, did I hear yesterday, and maybe it was Bernie Sanders who introduced yet again another financial transactions tax that we've been talking about for so long? I mean, if you put, you know, a fraction of a penny tax on each of those, you know, transactions that the computers whip out at, you know, millions a minute, this could raise some significant money without anybody feeling the pinch.
Senator Sanders has been on that issue for quite
a long
while. The House Democratic side came out with, within the income equality, came out with some proposals to go in and take some measures to have some assessments, and then that would be used to help the middle class with a $2,000 tax break. I would predict to you they're probably going to have to and will get more in depth, you know, with a more broader proposal, because I think that whoever starts to provide the, you know, the income vision for a lot of the average Americans is going to, you know, take the prize next round. Because on the heels of it, you have the Republican side, Nicole, who have done three things in the last week. One, we know about the 30 to 40 hour work week, which even the conservative think tank people don't want in the president's health care. The other thing they've done is Keystone, which they have 63 votes. They are not going to get to the 67 to have it veto-proof, but that's their mantra in the Senate. And in the House side, they stuck into the rules, as we all know by now, the potential cuts on Social Security disability of 20% into the rules of the House.
Mm-hmm.
The fourth faux pas is going to be, and Senator Johnson doesn't agree with this, I know, over in the Wisconsin region, but the fourth faux pas is going to be the fact of holding the president as hostage with Homeland Security over his immigration policies. I mean, what timing can be bad after the Paris attacks when you are not going to fully fund Homeland Security?
Right. Unbelievable.
So they've made some faux pas, and if the Democratic side's smart, they will continue to hammer home the economic side of this issue versus the Republicans. I mean, talk about bad timing, including Keystone, frankly, with the lower gasoline prices.
Right. I mean, because right now there is no sound argument in favor of it. If you're talking about, well, it'll lower our gas prices here, no, it won't, because producing a gallon of oil from those tar sands costs more, or a barrel would cost more than the cost of a barrel right now of oil. So how can you justify it?
Right. I just think that, you know, it's going to be a very fascinating time to watch what happens. One thing I wanted to note on the Supreme Court, which Talk Radio had provided some notes on this today, but they've avoided the gay marriage issue, and they've done it. It did deny Louisiana same-sex couples' request to skip the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals. Now, that's nothing really new. They really usually wait till the Court of Appeals will weigh in, okay? But the four other cases are from Kentucky, Michigan, Ohio, and Tennessee, and they came out of this past fall's decision from the Sixth Circuit Court of Appeals to uphold the bans in those states. And then the Sixth Circuit has been the only federal appeals court to find the bans to be constitutional, the only court. So the justices may weigh in on this again. But we have a system. We have X amount of states, and the Supreme Court makes a ruling, then decides to kind of temporarily take a walk on this one. So it kind of doesn't make sense.
No, it doesn't. But I understand from a conversation actually with Victoria yesterday that I think at the end of the week, they could decide to take it up again. They're going to have to. They can't just keep putting it off.
Well, because we'll have obviously a two-tiered system.
Mm-hmm.
In the country, as more states grow into having, I mean, look, you even have Jeb Bush, who mm-hmm. is now taking a a new morphed position on gay marriage.
Yeah, I don't believe anything he says.
The rule of law has spoken, but I'm just saying you even have Jeb Bush who's recognizing, you know, this is coming.
Right, right. and that brings us to the other news.
Bonjour, je m'appelle Mitt Romney.
Mitt 3.0. Boy, the man protested for so long. Oh, this is it. I'm not running again. And now that Jeb Bush is jumping in, here comes old Mitt again.
It's my turn.
Yeah, I guess he still thinks it's his turn.
Well, you know how we have the black on the right? When I was in Congress, we had the black helicopter people. They used to come in my office, you know?
Yeah.
I have the progressive helicopter theory now, you see. It's going to be out there pretty soon. I think that the progressives have somehow got to somebody to convince Mitt Romney can actually win. Yeah, I think
well, you know what? I don't think
you
it took...
You might be behind it. I'm not sure, but there's a plot.
I don't think it took the progressives. I think that the polls that came out... right around whenever it was, that said, Americans have buyer's remorse, and if the election was today, Mitt Romney would have won. You know, that went by for about a second. And he's such an opportunist and such a narcissist that he just wants to be president. And he thinks, he believes his own PR.
But the only thing better than Mitt running for Hillary Clinton would be Rick Santorum.
Well, he's already said he's running.
Yeah,
it's going
to
be,
got to.
Right. Mitt Romney is really that's now after all this, after the GOP autopsy and everything.
Look at the president made an issue of the finances, okay, and the releasing of the. Look at the first thing Jeb Bush did. He's releasing all his information.
He is.
All of it.
He is.
I mean,
and
where does Romney go from
well,
here?
Romney apparently has said, he's got the three pillars of his campaign. One of them is poverty. Really? Does anybody think that's genuine in any way, shape, or form after his whole 47% debacle? You think he all of a sudden found Jesus when it comes to helping the poor? Really good comment out of the chat room. Abby said, I believe the Mormon church is pushing Romney because, you know, that is in their doctrine that they want people and the highest levels of American government. And Mitt Romney was their best hope to get the White House. They already have an inordinate number of members of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints in what they call the three-letter agencies, CIA, FBI, IRS. And I mean, a lot of Mormons go into government because it's part of the church teachings to get as many people into government as possible.
Well, again, last week I would have told you, he's just kind of getting some attention. I think he's actually serious. So it'll be interesting to watch Bush and Romney kind of wipe each other out. And it might open up for some, dark horse to come in and run.
Yeah, but like who? I mean, who? Well, seriously, who?
You do have a couple of names I'd throw out there. Now, obviously, it's not Ted Cruz or Santorum. I'd still throw Rubio out there.
Now, let me ask you this, because as a Republican, I got when Barack Obama came on the scene. Grant, he was a first term senator, had just been elected, but there was such buzz about him, really, because of the speech that he delivered at the Democratic convention. And he was electric and magnetic. And everyone's like, oh, my God, listen to this guy. Marco Rubio has none of that. He's got no charisma. He's got no backstory. As someone from Florida who watched him as Speaker of the Florida House, he was a big nothing. So he comes from nowhere because he's young. And some consider good-looking and Hispanic, all of a sudden he's the great hope of the Republican Party? There's no there.
But you have to remember, Nicole, that we're doing him versus Mitt Romney, Jeb Bush, or Rick Santorum. Okay?
I guess there's no there in any of them. But really, all that Marco Rubio has is, again, it's subjective. I don't consider him attractive, but see, I know the man. I've met him in person. He kind of makes my skin crawl, so I don't call him attractive, but to some, I guess he is. But there's no gravitas there. There's no serious, there's no record, there's no nothing, except that what? He's Hispanic? They think that's all it takes to get the Hispanic vote?
I think they have. I mean, I've always argued, and people laugh at this, Republicans need a female at the top of the ticket. And everybody says, well, where are you going to get? Well, you know what? There might be an unknown out there, moderate office holder somewhere. And they say, well, they don't have name ID. Well, guess what? Run them and they will.
Yeah.
So, you know.
Right. Well, that's the other thing. You know, when you see the polls, like on the.
Nobody knew Sarah Palin.
Right. Nobody knew Sarah Palin. And the same thing, look, with Elizabeth Warren, not that she's running, but the average American has no clue who she is. Once she's out there campaigning for a few months, I have a feeling she'd bypass Hillary in the polls immediately. Oh, I've kept you way too long. Bob Ney. I
nice talking to you.
Then. Sorry. So thank you. Bob Ney of the Talk Radio News Service. Bye-bye. Find him at talkradionews.com. That was just getting so interesting. I had this question. I'm seeing Marco Rubio on TV again last night. And that question, just like, why is he considered a top-tier contender? He's a nothing. He's an empty suit whose parents came from Cuba. That's it. There's no there. He's Sarah Palin with a penis. Okay? That's my new line for Marco Rubio. Sarah Palin with a dick. You heard it here first. All right, let's take a break. I got lots of business to take care of. And the Gliberal Goddesses coming up next. Don't go away. I'm Nicole Sandler. It is radio or not.
Tales of American Political History with Clinton Porter Hackney.
We have begun a discussion of the interesting history of the President's Oval Office in the White House. Today, the Oval Office is the President's primary place of work, but it hasn't always been. The White House was first occupied in November of 1800, and its original build-out contained an oval room on the second floor, then referred to as the Yellow Room. Over a period of 144 years, five people helped shape the White House Oval Office that we know today. They were Theodore Roosevelt's wife, President Taft, Franklin Roosevelt, a guy named James Hoban, and the only president who never lived in the White House. Many presidents used the Yellow Oval Room as a private office or a library, and some chose to formally receive guests there. But join us again for some big changes at the White House. Clinton Porter Hackney at cphackney.com.
Hear about Old Mac Pope's Farm today on Hightower Radio. Old songs occasionally need refreshing with updated verses like this. Old Mac Pope had a farm, E-I-E-I-O, and on that farm he had a cow, a donkey, chickens, rabbits, E-I-E-I-O. Who knew that the Pope has a farm? 15 miles outside of Rome, Castel Gandolfo is a 50-acre plot of paradise on earth. It features Roman ruins, breathtaking views of the Tyrrhenian Sea, and, of course, a castle. Since the 1500s, this place has been a summer vacation home for popes. But in the 1930s, the Vatican added bucolic function by planting crops and bringing in some farm animals. And now, Pope Francis, who chose the patron saint of animals as his papal name, has opened the farm to the masses, welcoming us to witness the productive bounty of nature as well as its beauty. This is no hobby farm, but a sustainable enterprise that delivers a cornucopia of milk, yogurt, veggies, meat, cheese, honey, olive oil, and more to the Vatican every day. For this Pope, however, Castel Gandolfo is also a living metaphor, for it personalizes his message that we humans are, quote, stewards, not masters of nature, and that, quote, access to food is a basic human right that should not be subject to market speculation. He's been putting the power of his popeship behind religious and governmental policies that promote food justice, provide proper stewardship of natural resources, and combat the causes of climate change. All of which is part of his overarching call for a moral ethos that rejects, quote, the pride of dominating, possessing, manipulating, exploiting. This is Jim Hightower saying, by opening the papal farm to the public, Francis is providing a living model of a sustainable food system, and he's also extending his pastoral ideal of humility and openness. This guy really is the people's pope.
If you'd like more of Jim Hightower's real populism, check out the Hightower Lowdown. Jim's monthly newsletter gives you the real lowdown on which corporations, by name, are doing what to the middle class, our environment, and our democracy. Each month, the Hightower Lowdown brings you facts you didn't know, along with actions you can take to fight back. It also comes with a sense of humor. Hightower believes we can fight the gods and still have fun. Plus, get this, it's cheap. Only $15 brings you 12 issues a year. For real populism, go to HightowerLowdown.org.
This is the Media Matters Minute. I'm Coleman Lowndes. During recent appearances on Fox News to discuss the terrorist shootings in Paris, Emily Miller, chief investigative reporter for DC's Fox affiliate, pushed false information about gun violence. On Fox and Friends, Miller outrageously suggested that private gun ownership in the United States dissuades terrorists from launching attacks.
The Second Amendment is what keeps us safer from terrorist attacks because foreigners know we have guns.
Miller went on to baselessly claim that the terrorists responsible for the Charlie Hebdo attack chose France because the country is, quote, basically a gun-free zone.
Like the guy who, the camera phone at this horrible crime, and this policeman in Paris was shot in the head begging for mercy. Mm. The person who was taking that video, if they had been a concealed carry owner or like me, a gun owner, they could have shot the man, maybe put him on defense. But instead, they just watched and took a video.
Of course, it comes as little surprise that Fox News would choose to host Miller on this topic, as she's a frequent source of misinformation on gun violence. In fact, Media Matters research found at least 24 distortions about guns in Miller's recent book. For more on this and other stories, please visit MediaMatters.org.
Nicole Sandler with Babe's Irony.
Not that I'm any great shakes or anything, but I have gotten a lot of interview asks, but it's like, and I've turned most of them down just because of running around and being tired. But when you ask, I want to talk to you because you always do the best radio. And I'm just, thank you so much for having me on. It's my privilege.
The Nicole Sandler Show, weekdays 10 to noon on RadioOrNot.com. The Nicole Sandler Show remains on the air thanks to the support of listeners like you. Help keep her on the air by clicking the donate button on RadioOrNot.com. And thank you for your generous support.
Amy Simon of She's History. GottaLaff, out of the carnival and into Radio or Not. And Nicole Sandler.
Hello, goddesses.
The Nicole Sandler Show on RadioOrNot.com combined the forces of Amy, Laffy, and Nicole to bring to you the Gliberal Goddesses.
And here we are. Hello.
Yes, you've reached the Golden Globes hotline.
Oh, boy.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Press 1 if you think Mitt Romney should have gotten the award for most pathetic comeback attempt by an obscenely rich, blindingly white, self-serving, infantile, failed political hack.
Above the fruited plain.
I forgot all that. That was the worst piece of crap singing ever, and I'm bad. Okay,
I didn't know an answering machine could be so interactive.
Oh, no, that was my twin sister. This is the answering machine.
Awesome sauce! Sorry.
Yes! Oh, dear.
Yeah.
Back to character.
Yeah.
Press 2 if you think CENTCOM's Twitter account should have gotten the award for best adaptation of a hacked movie studio.
Ooh. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Fair enough.
Yeah.
Press 3 if you think Amal Almudeen should have gotten the Hey, Where's My Lifetime Achievement Award. Have a nice day.
Yeah. Again, let me just, the best, I must qualify this. I didn't see all of the Golden Globes. Silly me. I should have, DVR'd it. But even without seeing the rest of it, I know this was the best moment of the whole thing.
George Clooney married Amal Alamuddin this year. Amal is a human rights lawyer who worked on the Enron case, was an advisor to Kofi Annan regarding Syria, and was selected for a three-person UN commission investigating rules of war violations in the Gaza Strip. So tonight, her husband is getting a Lifetime Achievement Award.
It was just so, so perfect. I didn't even need to embellish it with my own applause.
You know, when that line came out, I said to Mr. Laffey, that is the line of the night. Yep. I didn't even know what was coming later. Yep. That was the line of the night. Now, here's what happened. So I tweeted it out. Someone sent me an image with those words on it, you know, so that it was like the whole thing. And I tweeted, got a ton of retweets. And then I started getting people tweeting me with things like, you know, she represented so-and-so when she was a lawyer. You know that this happened. And they were just bashing her. Hmm. And I said, first of all, a defense lawyer is supposed to defend people. That's our legal system.
Yep.
Some people are bad when they defend them. George Zimmerman. And other people are innocent, you know, and shouldn't be. You know, and they need to be defended, you know, very strongly.
Right.
So this is our legal system. So basically, you know, shut up.
Yeah.
But people were attacking, picking on these little things. And finally, they were saying, well, you know, first of all, she's not an actor, so she wasn't up for that kind of. I said, wait a minute.
Oh,
no,
my God.
You're not getting the intent of that joke.
Let me buy you a sense of humor.
Yes.
Ay, ay,
oh, it
ay.
Was pathetic. And I was being very patient because I thought, well, maybe they really didn't understand.
Yeah, I guess. Some people are just slower than others.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, Amy, I didn't mean that. You know, that was not a segue. That was just, hi.
Hi. Oh.
What are you doing?
Because you said, I love George Clooney so much, I can't even talk right now. And also, I must defend him immediately.
You must have offended him. What?
Defend
him. Oh, defend him.
Now, I thought that was also, you know, the greatest line of the night as well. However, there was a reason he won that award. I mean, Just on an aside, what about all his genocide watch?
You know what? Here.
Not on our watch.
Nobody's detracting from that.
Let me play this, because with all of the, you know, I've played that clip, you know, probably 5 or 6 times since, you know, in 2 days. What I haven't played is this, but I did pull it. This is George Clooney accepting his lifetime achievement, not the whole thing, don't worry, but listen to what he had to say here, because I think it's worth hearing.
I can't tell you what an honor it is to be up here. I thought they were going to roast me, but to be up here on the stage with Jules and Don. I've spent such a long part of my life and career with them, and it's been an unbelievable honor to watch them grow and mature, and probably been,
and I could have cut this part
fun
out
for them to
guess,
watch me not grow and not mature over the same period of time. Thank you to the Hollywood Foreign Press. You've always been very kind to me. And thank you for keeping small films alive. Big ones do fine. It's the little ones that need an audience. We want to find our Birdman. Now, it is always fun to come here and catch up with old friends. And now that we've seen that everybody's been hacked, it's also a good chance for us to meet face to face and apologize for all the snarky things we said about each other. I'm sorry, Don. So after coming here for several years and having lost a great much more than I've won, you start to see a pattern that happens on nights like this. All right, so you're on your way in, you're at the red carpet, and you're a nominee. Everybody's congratulating you. I mean, you're on top of the world, everybody. And then within a couple of hours, 4 out of the 5 of you don't win. Literally, 80% of the people in this room don't win. And then you are a loser.
Bonjour.
And I'm telling you, you go to the after parties, nobody will look you in the eyes. You go to work the next day.
That
was
the loser.
You know, guys, the crew comes over like, I'm sorry, pal. Yeah, meh. Get them next time. For the record, if you're in this room, you've caught the brass ring. You get
right?
to do.
Listen to this.
You get to do what you've always dreamed to do and be celebrated for it, and that just, it ain't losing. I don't remember what awards Lauren Bacall won. I just remember her saying, you know how to whistle, Steve, just put your lips together and blow. And I have no idea what kind of hardware Robin Williams took home. But I sure remember Carpe Diem.
Yep.
Seize the day, boys. Make your lives extraordinary.
Yep.
I'll never forget that.
Yep.
So congratulations to all of you for having a very good year. I've had a pretty good year myself, and I'm not just referring to the fabulous reviews of the Monuments Men.
Now listen to him here. This is awesome.
I'll get you back. Listen, it's a humbling thing when you find someone to love. Even better if you've been waiting your whole life. And when your whole life is 53 years, you, Amy, start the jokes.
Amy Poehler.
Whatever alchemy it is that brought us together, I couldn't be more proud to be your husband. And just one last thing I would say is just to reiterate what we've all been talking about. Today was an extraordinary day. There were millions of people that marched, not just in Paris, but around the world. And they were Christians and Jews and Muslims. They were leaders of countries all over the world. And they didn't march in protest. They marched in support of the idea that we will not walk in fear. We won't do it. So, je suis Charlie. Thank you.
I thought that was great.
It was. But what I want to make the point again, just because we're defending his wife is not in any way taking away from him.
No, absolutely
not. I know.
And
I know.
You
know
what? Well, no, it's not just
not
you.
At all.
I had Twitter people say the same thing to me, like, well, he, you know, he was great and look all the stuff he's done. Well, I'm not saying he didn't. That has nothing to do with that. That's two separate things.
Exactly.
Here.
And
I'm not saying that either. I'm
it
not
was
that
a
all.
Joke. No, I joke. Right. Funny. Ha ha.
But I tell you, if he weren't receiving that award, he would have been right on that line in Paris. In my opinion, nothing would have kept him away from being in that march on Sunday, except for that he was receiving that award. I think he would have skipped the Golden Globes, because I think his social justice work and charity work is more important to him. I think, and again, this is completely my opinion, and I have a good one because I'm completely in love with him and have been for years, is that the only reason he does films anymore is to support the work that he really wants to do. And I think that's what attracted him to her. I just love them.
You know, but let's not forget, some of us remember and had a crush on George Clooney on The Facts of Life. Remember, he was the handyman.
Yes.
I never saw that show.
Oh, my God.
I never even saw him until Roseanne. But I'm telling you, I didn't fall in love with him until I started seeing the work he was doing.
Right.
As, you know.
No, when he showed up on Facts of Google, George Clooney, Facts of Life, you'll see a very young, gorgeous George Clooney. And I remember, oh, my God, he's Rosemary Clooney's nephew, you know, and I knew Miguel Ferrer just from because he was good friends with Bill Mumy and that gang that I used to hang out with in L.A. And one time I was invited to Rosemary Clooney's house for Christmas. I've got a great, oh my God, do I have the best story ever. And Miguel was there, who's Rosemary Clooney's son. And I'm thinking, ooh, maybe George will be here. Of course he wasn't. But you want to hear my great Rosemary Clooney story?
Yes.
Bill Mumy's son, Seth, who just got engaged and I think is in law school now, was maybe 5 years old. And so we're at Rosemary Clooney's house, and they have a bunch of people over. Debbie Boone was there, who I think is Miguel Ferrer's sister-in-law. And, you know, so there's a mix of, you know, show busy people and just regular like me. I walk in the kitchen to get a drink or something. And there's Rosemary Clooney sitting at the kitchen table and little Seth Mumy, who is probably 5 years old. And I was like a fly on the wall because she's telling him, you know, Santa's coming. And she started singing, you better watch out.
God.
You better not cry. You better. And I'm thinking, is this really happening? Oh, my God. I can't believe I'm sitting here witnessing Rosemary Clooney singing Santa Claus is Coming to Town to little Seth Mumy. It was just one of those moments that will be forever etched in my mind.
Yeah. That's amazing. And do you remember his dad,
Nick Clooney.
Yeah. Nick Clooney.
Who did all the you know, the movie stuff.
Yeah, he hosted the movie.
Yeah, but George took him to Darfur. They went together.
Yes. Yep.
That's when that was when it all happened for me.
You know, and can I say, there are so many right-wingers who will criticize any activists on the left who use their celebrity to do good. Right. Look, yesterday was the fifth anniversary of the earthquake in Haiti. Well, did you know that Sean Penn went to Haiti? Set up an entire encampment. Yeah. He spent months and months there, poured I don't know how much of his money into it. Yeah. And what are the people like Rush Limbaugh on the right do? They criticize him.
Well, Sean, that made his cause.
The person who used their celebrity to go pretty far would be Ronald Reagan. So I don't understand how they can be that two-faced about it. But yeah, I mean, some of the work that celebrities have done is fantastic, and only they could do it. They have the wherewithal to do it.
Right. And George Clooney, in that acceptance speech, you know, poked fun at himself. It's that self-deprecating humor that we love. But about the Monuments Men, well, you know what? That was his project. He wanted to shine a spotlight on these people who risked themselves in order to save these great works of art from being destroyed by the Nazis. Now, the movie didn't get the critical acclaim he had hoped for or the success, but he said the little films, the big movies, they'll have an audience. It's the little films.
Right.
And that's what he's talking about, because he does more and more of these. And you think about some of the ones he's made. Some of the names I can't even remember, like Syriana, which and he's done more and more of these. The bigger his celebrity got, the more he could do these films that he thought spoke to a need.
It's like those big stores, you know, corporate stores taking over, and all the mom and pop businesses have been swept aside. It's the same kind of feeling when something is handcrafted as opposed to mass produced.
Uh-huh.
It's just that same feeling. It may not be the best parallel, but that's what it always reminds me of. And I love that he made that very public. Not too many people are even aware of that.
Right. No. And that's a good reason. It just underscores that he was deserving of this award. I really think he was.
Because, I totally do too.
Right. He's turned out to be a really great actor, from someone who came out of, you know, goofy sitcoms, turned out to be a great actor and somebody who puts his money where his mouth is.
Oh, the Ides of March and, The Good Night, Good Luck. That was amazing.
Oh, Good Luck, Good Night, Good Luck. That was awesome.
Yeah.
So good for him. On the other hand, I guess Tina Fey and Amy Poehler said this would be their last time hosting.
They said that last year.
What a shame, because can I just say, they need to host every single fucking award show.
They are so good. But a little ray of sunshine, didn't it look to you like maybe Kristen Wiig and Hader would be the up and coming.
Oh,
Bill Hader would be the next duo, because
they do nothing for me. I'm sorry.
Well, I love her.
I don't.
I just think she's adorable. But
I just don't.
But that's I don't think
I don't
they
know,
compared.
Kathy.
What?
I think the reason that they were on is because of their film.
They've
skeleton.
Got a movie. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely. But it starts somewhere. That was their introduction. It just seemed to me that they were a possible choice coming up. It just occurred to me as they were up there.
But, you know,
the chemistry is fantastic.
I see it. Neither one of them are very appealing to me. And sorry, I can't imagine Bill Hader and Kristen Wiig playing Who Would You Rather?
No. I totally agree. Nothing tops
Tina
Fey and Amy Poehler. That was hilarious.
You know, it's so great when you see, you know, and not because they're female, but just to see two fantastic artists in their prime, at the top of their game. And I think because they're both so happy and successful in their careers that they don't really give a shit so much.
Exactly.
And that's what makes their timing so perfect. And just their whole thing, like, they're just on the top of their game. I love them.
And yet there was a ratings drop of 8%.
Was there?
Mm-hmm. Huh. I would have thought that they would have generated higher ratings, the two of them. They're so fantastic. I mean, I totally agree with everything you guys have said. They are my top pick forever.
Right.
Forever. My comment was just that I the other two stuck out as like, I wonder if they're pushing them for the next one. That's all.
Oh.
It occurred to me.
Laffy, I think you'll get this big time, because one of the greatest rules of comedy is leave them wanting more.
Oh,
right?
Leave them laugh. Yes.
Leave them wanting more. Leave them wanting more. That's what I was taught, and that's what I always try to do, which is why the Saturday Night Live sketches go on too long.
Oh, my God.
So it's part of the reason the Dick Van Dyke Show ended when it did.
Yeah. Yeah. So what I'm saying is that's such a good rule. And I think that's why they said last year that they were only going to do it one more time. Mm-hmm. And I think they're going to be awfully careful about what they're going to do together, because they've got to be inundated with offers to host everything on the planet.
They don't want it to become the thing that they're known for. Exactly.
They're too smart. They're too independent. Yeah. But they're smart about knowing how to leave them wanting more.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah.
They were so great. So,
I could see them hosting special, lifetime achievement shows. You know, I can't think of which one.
Take over for Oprah, the person of the year. Yeah. I want them to do award shows, because award shows are just so lame.
Yeah.
And except with them hosting, oh my God, all of a sudden it's entertaining. Then again, the Golden Globes is different than any other award show. It's a little looser, probably because they're all sitting. They're sitting at tables and they're drinking.
Remember last year, Amy Poehler sat on George Clooney. Did she make out with Bono? Bono.
Sonny.
That was a Freudian slip, if ever there was one. But do you remember that last year? She sat on his lap and then she's like, oh my God, I just kissed Bono.
I do remember that. Yeah, well, we'll see who they get. But, it's like when Billy Crystal left the Oscars. He kept it alive. He was good at picking up. He was good at improv. His energy was high. He was consistently keeping things moving. And then when they got, who was it? Anne Hathaway and what's his name?
Oh, Franco.
Oh, God. Franco. James Franco. That was deadly.
That was horrible.
Torture.
That was deadly.
It was torture.
It was really torturous. And they knew it. Didn't he leave in the middle?
Well, and I guess Anne Hathaway has made light of it, at length.
Yeah.
So.
Oh, she hung in there. I thought, first of all, to defend her a little bit, if I recall, she did, or maybe it was on a different show where she did a whole singing number. I think it was the Tonys where she did a whole number with Hugh Jackman where she was singing and dancing. I mean, she's really talented, but not a host. That's a really specific skill.
Right. But who else is really good? And I'm looking forward to him on the Oscars, Neil Patrick Harris.
Yeah.
He's brilliant. Now, I didn't see on Broadway, his whole Broadway, he did Hedwig and the Angry Inch. Let me tell you something. Go find the movie and rent it. It is so good. And this predates the play by a decade at least. It was so good. I'd love to see him on Broadway doing it. I'm sure he's already gone from it. But, oh, my God, the fact that he can do this stuff. Talk about a guy who has completely reinvented himself since we first knew him as Doogie Howser.
Yeah, he was put on this earth to do exactly what he did on the Tonys and to do Broadway. He is a song and dance man. His comic, his comedy, his timing. He was just born.
He's a superstar.
He's got it.
He did an absolutely acrobatic number.
Yes,
in the Tonys, and he was
your breath away.
He kept it, and he could sing during it. And then after he was done, he could talk.
Yeah,
I mean, I'm getting winded if I walk to the kitchen.
Yesterday I got to tell you this. This is really yesterday there is a new channel on Sirius XM, channel 121. It's called Insight. And John Fugelsang has a show on it from 2 to 5 Eastern. So it's, earlier out there. I can't do math this early in the morning. But no, so John Fugelsang is on it. Pete Dominic is on it. Margaret Hoover, for whatever reason. Dino Badala has a weekend show. I think Neil deGrasse Tyson has a weekend show. I'm not sure if their full lineup is done. Anyway, so yesterday was John Fugelsang's first show. And I'm listening on the way to the gym. I went to the gym. I had a really hard workout. And I thought on the way home, I should call in, just like congratulate him. Because I've been bemoaning the fact that since Randy Rhoads went off the air, I have nothing to listen to in the afternoon. Nothing against Michelangelo Signorelli, who used to be on the Out Cute channel, which is like the LGBT channel. They moved him onto what they call Progress 127, which is their progressive talk station. And I just find him unlistenable. Nice guy. I've met him. His show is just, it's just boring. I can't. I flip around. There's no local radio worth a hoot here in South Florida. And so in the afternoon, there was nothing of substance, to listen to. And so I called in. I'm on hold for, a little while as I'm driving home. And when I finally got on, I was still so so out of breath from working out. I don't know what I sounded like. I know a lot of people like tweeted, "Oh, Nicole," and I got in a you know a zinger, like, you know, always available for fill-ins. Yeah, I mean, this was, you know, a good 20 minutes after I left the gym. I was still out of breath.
Maybe they thought you were just turned on by John.
Well, yeah, John Fugelsang, you know.
Can I tell a little John Fugelsang story?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. First of all, I met John Fugelsang many years ago when we both did a storytelling show, and I can't remember the name of it right now, but I was doing a piece of Cheerios in my underwear.
Right.
And people were doing little bits, and all of a sudden, this man walks into the theater for, you know, the pre-show before the audience. This tall drink of water with a leather jacket, my mouth hung open. I'm like, oh my God, I completely fell in love because he's so gorgeous and sexy. And then he went up, you know, and did the show with us, and he did his 10 minutes of what turned into his one-man show. That's how I met John Fugelsang. And I turned him on to you, Nicole.
Yes,
right?
You did. You provided the introduction for me to John Fugelsang.
Here's the good part, is then he started to do this political comedy show in Los Angeles called Comedy Nation. Laffy, does it ring a bell with you?
Vaguely,
because I wanted to talk to you about it. Well, his producer is Bill Bronner. Again, I don't know how I know Bill, but they did the first one, which they filmed many years ago, and I was in it. You know, it was like they were trying it out, and I sat on a stool with a piece of paper and read a story about Victoria Woodhull. It was when I first started doing She's History. Well, last year, they brought Comedy Nation back to a little theater, and he's got like Rick Overton and all these people, you know, great people, political people on the show, political comics. Well, they're doing it again in February, mm-hmm. And I got an email from Bill Bronner saying, and I wanted to, and I, so I said, hey, I'd like to come on. And actually, Laffy, I was going to ask you to come on, that maybe, ooh, you know, we could talk about this later, because you're actually more for the show than me, because you're, you know, you're smarter and more political, and, you know, I'm more specific.
No.
I know, and cuter. Anyway, here are the topics that they sent out that they're going to be talking about. I think the show... It's their first Comedy Nation show. It's at a theater that I know very well. Obamacare.
Right.
It's the Fanatic Salon, which is run by a friend of mine named Jane Morris. A little sweet little theater in West LA. Oh. And everybody's friends with you know, Bill Bronner went on Facebook and said, "Oh, I'm looking for a little theater." And then, you know, people said, "Oh, I have one because we love right. John. He's an old friend."
Five hands went up immediately.
Yeah. So here are the topics that he's considering for us to say if we want to do a monologue about: Obamacare. Justice in America, only for the rich. The new trend in genocide, is hate popular? GMOs in my food, don't ruin my appetite. Why should my kid go to college? What's trendy, what's not? Conspiracy, who's trying to fool me? Religious extremism, how stupid can it get? You know, he's just throwing some stuff
right.
out. But I actually taped the one last year, and it's sitting somewhere in my laptop because he did they pick these topics, they get these really cool people, like you, Laffy, to come on and do a monologue, and then they all chit-chat, kind of like what we're doing. So I'm looking forward to it. And, Nicole, when they do it, I'll go to the show. I don't know if I'll be in it, but I'll go, and I'll report back.
Okay.
You'll have to call
when
me,
is
and,
it?
And we'll talk about
when
this.
Is it?
February. I'm trying to find the date now. It's sometime in February. I'm sorry I don't have it in front of me.
Okay, no worries. We've got time before February. Okay. Well, that sounds like fun.
Oh,
I miss being in L.A.
I miss you being in L.A.
I know, and I didn't even know you when I lived in L.A.
I know, that sucks. That just really sucks.
It really does. Oh. It really does. But you know, I'm thinking there are some good things about being here. At the moment, I can't tell you what they are, but, you know. We don't have a drought. We don't have earthquakes.
That's good. But you do have Marco Rubio.
Oh, my God. Yeah, so that's why I know about Marco Rubio. The man is a moron.
He is.
Palin with a dick, I'm telling you. It could catch on.
Palin with a dick. Oh, but the problem is, does he really have a dick?
I don't know, but he has no balls.
There you go.
So, you know, the dick without the balls, what good is it?
I'm 12.
Well, I'm 10.
And I'm glad.
All right. What else is going on this week? I'm trying
I sent you a bunch of stuff.
You did.
Nicole.
I know you did.
It was women's stuff.
Yeah.
But can we just talk for a minute about, I was going to say when we mentioned Sean Penn, it would be a good segue to Charlize Theron, because the Sony hack revealed her. what was going on with her paycheck. So she went and said, hey, I understand that my I'm going to try to find the article, but she wanted the same pay as Chris Hemsworth because she, after the leaked email, I'll read you the, this is from, I forget who sent this, Think Progress or something. After leaked emails in the Sony hack showed unequal pay between male and female actors, Charlize Theron insisted she get the same pay as her male co-star, Chris Hemsworth, for The Huntsman. She succeeded. Ready? Yep. Netting a $10 million increase.
Raise. Oh, my God.
That's how much less she was
and
getting.
And can we say that Charlize Theron is an Academy Award winner?
What about Jennifer Lawrence?
She won for the woman who was in jail, the monster. Right. She was great in that. Jennifer Lawrence, another perfect example, won Best Actress last year, right? And was still paid less than her male co-stars. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Gee, what is that called?
Bullshit?
Sexism, double stand. She's history. Yeah. Crazy. $10 million.
Yep.
So thank you, hackers. You actually did one good thing.
Right.
I think they did an amazing thing.
Every time there's a hack, there are things revealed that we do want to know and that we should know. And as awful as that was, I'm glad this came out of it. This was a really big silver lining, and I hope this continues.
Good time, darling.
That's right.
And as far as Anonymous, they've already hacked into some of the websites of the people that they threatened, the ISIS types. They've already hacked into four, maybe five sites where you can't get onto the sites anymore.
Right, the jihadists, they did DDoS attacks.
Yeah.
We hate it when that happens to us. It happened to our chat room not too long ago, right? It wasn't just us. Oh, Chatango, which is the program we use for our chat room, a few weeks ago, it was down for 2 or 3 days.
I did not know that.
Yep. So, I hate when that shit happens. But when it's hacking for good, that's why I found that the conversation with Ralph fascinating.
Absolutely
in the first hour.
Absolutely fascinating. That is one impressive guy.
Yep. He is. And I could have listened to him for hours.
Yeah, me too. That's what I said. He called in early. He was supposed to call in at 10:30. And I saw he showed up at like 10:22. I'm like, screw it. I'm just going to talk to him now. And we could have gone for another 40 minutes.
Now, here's the only negative I've heard about Anonymous hacking into that, doing that kind of thing. This is not me speaking. This is only what I have heard somebody else say, and that is it can complicate efforts to get them through other channels, through secret,
Right.
What I'm saying?
Right, so for like governments tracking them.
Yeah. So I personally, I don't really care, because I'm just so getting off on them doing this. I just loved the two video messages they put out. They were played, on TV, and it was sort of like, yeah, go get those guys. That's so cool. Because Anonymous to me is like Robin Hood or whatever it was.
Yes, that was a perfect analogy. Robin Hood.
Yeah.
A perfect analogy. When the news broke about them, going after the KKK in Ferguson, I actually reached out to the group that was, taking responsibility for it via Twitter. And somebody got back to me immediately. And I said, would you consider coming on the air with me? And he said, we would love to, but honestly, because of the security things, we would have to go through so many steps in order to get a secure phone line. And so he's like, it's just not practical.
Yeah.
He said, if you want to send us questions, I'm happy to answer them and send them back. And which I opted not to do. But, I was kind of impressed that they didn't just want to come on the phone because they're that sophisticated.
And committed to what they're doing.
That's right. And when you keep in mind that what they're doing is illegal, they need to protect themselves. And the last thing I would want to do is put them in peril because I think the work they're doing is so important. And you got to wonder, why can't our law enforcement do that? But I guess technically they can't. Somebody working for the U.S. government can't take down a website they find offensive like the KKK because, hey, free speech. But Anonymous can sure do it.
Right. That's why there's, you know, mixed feelings about them. Some people hate them. Other people love them. I happen to really like them.
Yeah.
I watch their Twitter stream, and almost invariably they come out with a message that I go,
Great. They're great. Now, let me ask you guys about this. One of the big winners at the Golden Globes the other night was, you know, Jeffrey Tambor won for his portrayal of a transsexual
transgender. It's a father who's 70 years old who has secretly, known exactly what he needs to do, and finally at age 70 decided to do it.
Right.
And he becomes openly trans, and he tells his family, and it deals with the neurosis of his kids and the acceptance and the rejections, and it's a fantastic show. Go Amazon.
Right. So it's on Amazon. That's the point I'm making. I mean, HBO and the networks were pretty much shunned, right? Well, now the news breaks today that Amazon has signed Woody Allen to write and direct a new TV series.
Yeah, he's going to do a half hour for Amazon. That's right.
Right. So what do you guys think about that? I know Amy's reacting more than laughing.
I think it's great, and I'm not one bit surprised that the new technology has created a completely new form of entertainment. I know I've been talking about it. I work for a nonprofit, and there's an entertainment division, and we were talking about that too, how it has changed the entire landscape of entertainment, and it's been going on for a while.
Right, but I'm not
Netflix
talking about the whole Amazon thing. I'm talking about the Woody Allen thing.
Woody Allen.
Mean, I would not go and watch anything with Bill Cosby in it right now. I'm squeamish about Woody Allen.
I am too. I'm conflicted.
Am too.
I didn't want to see, the last movie I saw of his, Jasmine. And I believe that's what
Blue
it was called.
Blue Jasmine. And it was a very good movie.
Yeah.
I watched it not too long ago when it was on like HBO or something. I didn't want to pay for it.
I think it's a great thing that you're talking about, Nicole, because I mean, we should talk about how Amy Poehler and Tina Fey knocked the shit out of Bill Cosby.
For those who didn't hear it, it is, let's see, is it right?
And it wasn't the first time they did that on Saturday Night Live years ago.
Right. Okay, here's the clip.
Selma. In the 1960s, thousands of black people from all over America came together with one common goal, to form Sly and the Family Stone. But the movie Selma is about the American Civil Rights Movement that totally worked, and now everything's fine.
Right, and now they go
great
into
line.
The... Oh, shit. Yeah. Oh, wait a minute. So what did I do with the Cosby line? I had it here. All right, I'll find it. You go ahead, Amy.
I don't want to blow the, if you're going to find it. I mean, they did this thing about Into the Woods.
Oh, that's it was. It was the Into the Woods.
But no, they also did, they both did their impersonations of him. But when they talked about Into the Woods and they said, Rapunzel let down her hair and, Cinderella left her slipper and Sleeping Beauty thought she was just going to get a cup of coffee with Bill Cosby.
Right. Yeah. That was the line.
And everybody like gasp, but good for them.
Somebody on my
Facebook page said, every time somebody likes my page, I'm going to make a Bill Cosby joke, which I don't think it's funny, but that's, we're just up in arms about the whole thing. And I'm really upset that Felicia Rashad, she went and defended him. And I'm like,
and then she backed off a little bit the next day.
Oh, a little bit,
but not enough. Look, where there's smoke, there's fire. And, let me also just say this. I know Selma didn't win any awards, I don't think, the other night. But yesterday I mentioned that I was conflicted about Selma because it's getting great reviews. People say it's so powerful. It's amazing. I mean, John Lewis, who's depicted in there, said it's so important, it's an important thing, although they're pointing out, yes, there are historical inaccuracies when it comes to LBJ, because they portrayed him as saying to Martin Luther King, well, we're going to have to wait on the Voting Rights Act and put it off because we, and basically creating conflict. And you guys know about dramatic license. So I guess they thought they needed more conflict in that story, which I find absurd. So I mentioned my trepidation about seeing it. And our buddy Tripp, who is sometimes in the chat room, sent me an email yesterday and he wrote to me, Johnson was a bigoted guy. In my households, the two Kennedy gents and Martin were held up as civil rights lions. Johnson was a guy we were taught to treat with indifference. Perhaps it's from this perspective that the director made the film. Make no mistakes, though, he was a virulent bigot. And I wrote back, I said, as were most white Southerners. The fact that he was a bigot makes the fact that he did work to get the Voting Rights Act passed shouldn't be obscured. As I said, there's plenty to criticize him for. They didn't need to embellish. And so Tripp wrote back, and he said, not having seen it, I can't say it was embellished. I do believe a lot of history is written by the victor. I think it is a bit revisionist the way we deal with some of our former leaders. Sure, Lincoln signed the Emancipation Proclamation, but he also had every intention of deporting blacks to Central America had he lived. I plan to watch Selma. I hope you do too. And then he said, what if I buy your ticket? You know, I'm one of your biggest fans. Would love to give you a couple of seats at, and he names a couple of really nice movie theaters here. He said, that way you didn't support the film financially, and I'm hopeful to convert your opinion, evil laugh, by you loving the acting performances. Let me know. And then he said, either way, love the way you can disagree and still be so sound and rational and just awesome. So thank you, Tripp. And because of that, I will go see the movie. You know,
well, the director has said that that people are picking on the one part of the movie, but that in the context of the movie, it's a minor thing, and they she's
but
a little bit
in history
that
in
that's
history
what they chose to. Yeah,
but you know, you're telling a historical story, and there's a very fine line. I understand dramatic license, but on a point like this, where, you know what, Johnson was a racist. He was a Southern guy in the early 60s. And the fact that he went against his own tendencies to work with Martin Luther King to pass the Voting Rights Act, I think is something that should not be, not only belittled, but totally obscured, so he's made right to look like he fought against it. That's a big historical fact that you don't look, we already have too many racial tensions in this country. You don't need to inflame them. Give the guy credit for one of the good things he did.
Right.
You know, there was plenty of conflict there. If you need conflict for your story arc, lots of heads bashed in Selma, right? You didn't need to create this conflict where it didn't exist. With that, you know, I also have a question on other things that are historic. I don't know if either of you has watched the TV show Masters of Sex.
No.
And it's a dramatization of Masters and Johnson. It's great, but I wonder how much of it is real and how much is dramatic license. And I want to know.
Unless something is called a documentary, then I am liberal with my views about movies like that.
Right.
I allow them the license to do what they do, as long as maybe they should put a disclaimer or something if that's right what everyone's worried about.
But
no,
still,
this is not an actual depiction.
It's
not
a documentary, but if it's even a docudrama, points of,
you're gonna influence
obviously
people.
Every word of dialogue is not going to be fact, but major legislation like the Voting Rights Act, you really need to, you need to stay true to history. We have enough of right-wingers trying to rewrite history that we don't need a movie, mischaracterizing, the president and his role in passing the Voting Rights Act. Because
people take it literally.
That's right. That's right. Anyway, we've run long just because we can, but it is time to go. Gotta Laugh, find her these days blogging at radioornot.com. And Amy Simon, find her these days at shes history.com. And you've got a performance coming up, don't you, or a reading of the play?
Actually, I don't, but I did have a reading last night at my new theater company.
Oh, it was last night.
Right.
It was thrilling. It was so thrilling to be in my new theater, Theater West in Los Angeles. And they do these workshops. It's a, it's a theater that really develops plays and develops acting, So I got together six actresses and we just did some of the show, 30 minutes of it. And I got a great feedback from the audience. And it was thrilling for me to get the response. People were in love with it, mostly not just the women. There were men that loved it too. I got some great ideas about how to make it more theatrical and dramatic because, as I always say, it's a wonderful solo play. And when you get all these other actresses in it, you have to really make it theatrical. And so I can't wait to develop it. It was a very exciting evening and just the beginning for me. So I don't have any performances coming up at the moment. And as soon as I do, I'll put them on my website.
Cool. Let me say one last thing, and that is, because we haven't talked about it, I mentioned it earlier, but Elizabeth Warren scored a big victory this week.
Yes.
Yeah.
That Antonio Weiss, the Wall Street guy who President Obama wanted to name to the number three post at Treasury, officially withdrew his name from contention, asked the president not to renominate him in this session of Congress because of the opposition from the Democrats. Mm-hmm. That's Elizabeth Warren showing that persistence pays. And if we stay together, we stick together, and we stay hold true to our principles, anything is possible.
Right.
Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it is the only thing that ever has. Margaret Mead, thank you.
And with that, what a note to end on. Amy Simon, Gotta Laugh, the Gliberal Goddesses. I'll talk to you later, ladies.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.
All right. So with that, we're going to say goodbye to YouTube, because I do go out with a song after every show, but I can't play them on YouTube because they ding me with a copyright violation. So we don't want that. So bye, YouTube. See you tomorrow. Same time, same channel. Radio or not.